My name is Prachi Sakhardande. That's me as seen through the eyes of my 7-year-old, who also happens to have an eye for detailing. Though I don't, you know, usually carry flowers in my hand, it's my laptop more often than not. But the other thing is my Kindle with Game of Thrones, GOT, which is, alright. So I'm a working mom. I also think I'm all these things, which I think are kind of essential for what we do. I had product experience, like she was saying, a group called Component Engineering Group at Tata Consultancy Services. What my group does is it's actually a part of TCS's non-linear initiative where we work on a lot of products for our customers, for our even in-house people, a lot of technology products across domains, retail, healthcare, forecasting, so on and so forth. I also suffer from malconsumulium phobia, which I made up, but essentially it is fear of bad design. Mal is bad, consumulium is design. And because I'm a drama queen, I hope I can eradicate bad design from the face of the earth, but you know, even if I do it in my own whatever space, I think it's good. When I started kind of, putting my talk together, this whole track of women in design really kind of, flummoxed me, because I didn't know what I was bringing in to the table different as a woman. So I got thinking, and these were the things that kind of came to me, that as a woman, curiosity, collaboration, and empathy are kind of, we are genetically predisposed to it. So we often know what's happening in our neighbor's house more than our husbands do. You know, if the uncle who kind of waves to us every morning doesn't turn up for 2 days, we'll go and check. Collaboration, yes, because, I mean, it's nature, nurture, but I think it's kind of become a way of survival for women, taking consensus, moving along, and empathy. So whether it's like our genes or, whether that's the way we have evolved and survived in the society, but these have kind of become inherent in what we do. Now, I will need you to hold this thought for a bit while I jump to my next slide, which is about design thinking. And I think we've been hearing a lot about design thinking over the last 2 days, and now actually for quite some time. So design thinking is like an in thing, right? It's the designer's new black. What really is design thinking? So if you really look at the methodology, it does have curiosity, collaboration, and empathy at its core, which I think as women, it gives us an edge. If you look at the methodology itself, I guess a lot of you are familiar with the DT double diamond. So you start with a high level design brief. Then you typically would go on to your discovery phase, which is your user research, which is divergent, that you are broadening the canvas. This converges in the form of insights, and then what you have is a problem statement. Once you've defined, once you've nailed down your problem statement, you're going ahead. Again, you're diverging in terms of trying out various solutions. No idea is wrong as long as it is executed cheaply in the form of prototypes, fast, and then you hopefully nail down your final solution. Right? Now, if you look at the entire life cycle, you see that empathy, collaboration, curiosity, they are inherent in the entire design diamond, double diamond flow. So, because DT is a structured methodology for finding answers to difficult questions or finding solutions to problems, how about we as designers apply it to ourselves? Why? Because we also get asked a lot of questions. So things like, we've built the application, can we fix the UI? Can you make it look good by tomorrow? Why do you need to talk to the users? I'll tell you the problems. Just fix the colors. Why are you asking so many questions? Why wireframes? Just give me the HTMLs. And what do you mean this needs to be simplified? You just train them. Anyone in the room who's not been exposed to these questions, I'd really like to meet you. Yeah? So if these are the kinds of questions that, and you know, I'm not talking like a new thing, right? Over and over, years and years, every conference we kind of touch on this us versus them kind of a thread. So why not do our own user research? Why not get in our end user perspective? And I'll get in a little bit of context here. The context that I'm talking from, and because context is so important to what we do, right? So I'm talking about an experience design team that works in a large, very conservative IT company, like Marbury was telling, you know, built by engineers for engineers. Who are our service consumers? Tech leads, project managers, developers. How can we do our user research? How can we understand, you know, what are their pain points? So one of the things that we practice very religiously is doing these CSAT surveys after every delivery. And it's not a matter of protocol or procedure or some process that we have to follow because someone has told us, but we've realized that it's a dire need. So every team member is really serious about getting these CSATs, finding out, you know, what worked well, what didn't, and taking those findings back into improving our process. Root cause analysis, so you get a CSAT lower than 90. You do a root cause analysis, you call them, you have a one-on-one. Sometimes, you know, it's you just didn't have the right people or you didn't have people at all, which led to frustration. More often than not, it's a lot of misunderstandings which, you know, causes. One-on-one discussions, collaborative workshops, focus groups. So these are all the things that we apply, you know, for our users, our customers, but how are applying it to themselves? So we did this, the discovery phase. Now, once we've done this, problem statement. So we gathered all these insights, we took a step back, and again, I want you all to remember our context, you know. A small design team in a large, fairly conservative IT company. And this is the problem statement that we came up with. So design is a microcosm in larger engineering-centric world of IT companies. As long as it is considered mysterious mumbo-jumbo, design and designers will always be treated as others. Okay? And, you know, because it will continue to be an us versus them situation, at the end, we are losing out. We are losing out on making good products. Okay? Because every designer, I'm sure every designer worth his or her salt, wants to, at the end of the day, you know, do good work and go home. So then, how can we bring in more transparency, structure, and openness, and create a symbiotic relationship with the larger IT community? And that is what the next part of my talk talks about. So this is all based on our experience, our learnings, which I thought I will share with you. Drawing on our experiences, inputs, discussions, we came up with a series of possible solutions. These are in the perpetual prototype phase. So they will have to keep evolving, they will have to keep changing because people change, mindsets change, cultures change. So I think this is a beautiful word, perpetual prototype. We've been prototyping these solutions. I'm not going to go into how we prototype, but I'm going to talk about what has worked. So the TIE acronym is what evolved out of, you know, this entire exercise that we've been doing for almost 3.5-4 years now. Transparency, involvement, and evolution. Okay. So let's look at this one by one. How do you bring in more transparency? Methodology, quality, and metric. If we talk about methodology, okay, what do we mean by methodology? We all use user-centered design, right? So what more do I get in, you know? How can we look at transparency in user-centered design? But if you look at an overall process, our integration with the software development lifecycle, then you will find that there are a lot of interesting gaps which can actually be overcome through a little bit of design thinking. Does everybody work with effort estimation templates? Yeah? All right. So, okay, this is how it happens in my organization. we get like a design problem. My team works on the effort estimation. By the time we work and we give, you know, the efforts back, we realize that the project plan is already gone. And you know, they have estimated something, and then, you know, often that something is like 1/4 of what you'd actually need. How about then empowering the project managers to estimate? So we have data, we have ballparks, we know that, you know, this is the total size of the project, that this is tentatively the effort that is going to be needed for estimations. Why not empower them, you know, with these numbers, with this data, so that some decisions they can take themselves without having to come back to us every time? It's all about empowerment, right? SLAs, handshake, sign-off mechanisms. Now, again, you know, this can sound obvious, but let me give you a scenario. I'm working on a design, and we show it to our customers. They don't like it. It comes back. Iteration 1, iteration 2, iteration 25. End of the day, everybody is frustrated. Timelines are delayed, right? Why not set up a proper process, proper mechanism upfront? There, you just make it formal that, okay, we work up to iterations, 3 iterations. Anything after that, it's taken as a CR. Right? I mean, they do follow it in functional development all the time. Why can't we learn from these well-structured, you know, proven processes? Okay, this is an interesting one. It kind of, the germ of this came from, again, my engineering colleagues in TCS. See, when you talk about functional development, there's a very strong traceability that exists, right? From requirement to design to development to testing. So we were working on this initiative, and we were trying to create the same kind of a traceability when it comes to user experience. How do you define user experience requirements? How do you put them in a system? I think that's a very interesting problem to solve. The second part of it, the quality. So we've actually invested, one of my attributes I put in as an inventor, we've got patents on assessment models. How do you assess the quality of user experience? How do you assess the quality of visual design? We use a lot of application lifecycle management tools. We have processes where bugs that come out of UX are put into a system, and they're analyzed every quarter. We want to see where our development teams are going wrong. How about bringing in UI testing for automation? So, you know, some part of UI testing, you're testing again and again and again. There are frameworks, there are tools like Selenium out there, which could be leveraged to do UI testing. So all these are going to make your process more efficient, more robust, more transparent, bring in more credibility. metric, I can't emphasize this enough, but I'm guilty of it. I'm sure many of you all are. We do not define the metric up front. Only now we've started, formally phrasing the problem statement, but even then, why am I solving this problem? What is going to be the measure of success of my design? How many times do we deliberate, discuss, formalize it? Okay. The second part is involvement. So here, partnership and collaboration, enablement, sustained mentoring. See, it's all about collaboration, it's all about empowering, it's all about working together. So, unless we empower others to do some of what we do, it's not going to be possible for us to move on to bigger things. We want to be strategists, right? How can we be strategists if we are only fighting on wireframes? So, cultivating product experience champions, that is something that our top management has like really been pushing down. Initially, even we were a bit, resistant, because how do you train an engineer to be a designer? But with sustained mentoring, with a lot of patience, we realize that, every now and then in a project team, we will unearth someone who has an aptitude for design. Work with them, mentor them, and they become the product experience champions of their group. Work alongside product managers in agile sprint. Easier said than done, I know. But I think as designers, we need to have an equal say in the kind of user stories that are going in. We need to have a say in what is going out in the MVP, right? Empowering non-designers, this is, I think, fairly obvious. But important thing here is digitizing design guidelines, into plug-and-play components, rather than just relying on people to follow what you're doing. formal trainings, WBTs, that is web-based trainings, instructor-led sessions, mentoring. Finally, fostering an environment of trust, collaboration, and kinship. Because as women, as designers, we want to take everybody together and move forward. The last of the TIE acronym, evolution. Staying relevant and doing whatever it takes to design great experiences. And that means that we as designers also have to evolve beyond UX. So facilitating innovation through design thinking workshops, standing up and saying that yes, I will participate in strategy. My work is not only, you know, implementation. Taking in unusual assignments, right? So like mystery shopping to assess customer experience. We've done that for Airtel. We went and we actually sat in the email centers and we sat in their stores and tried to figure out what is wrong. Mystery shopping. Customer experience assessment. So nowadays, instead of saying that we will be user and heuristic evaluations and usability reviews, we try to say that let us get onto the entire gamut of your experience touch points and even customer experience assessment. Service design, IVRS design, space design. See, everything is in your mind, right? You will decide where you will draw the boundaries. Also, very important investment in research and innovation. So these are some of the areas that my team is very aggressively working on because we really believe that is the way forward. Finally, own the entire product experience. So stop calling yourself user experience designers. We are experience designers. We own the entire experience. We are custodians of the experience. What I mean, my entire product experience is this. Okay. I've run out of time. Thank you for your patience. I will leave you with this. Thank you.
Right. So, ma'am, you were talking about limiting the design iterations to, say, 2 iterations, 3 iterations. So that's actually one of the pain points for us as well. But, coming from a design thinking point of view, which encourages you to, think of more and more ideas. So it doesn't that contradict with, limiting to 3 iterations when on the other side, we say that you, as a design thinker, you should think of all the different possibilities and so I'm kind of a bit confused there.
So I think there's a time and place for everything. So when you're doing your user research or when you're, doing your low fidelity prototype testing, that is actually when you will go, on and on with your iterations. But once you have nailed the idea, it's more about the visual design, presenting the design options. You have to put a stop somewhere, right? And that's where I think we need to take a stand.
Later on in the process, the iterations have to come down.
So most of the iterations we've seen happen as a visual design, someone likes a blue, someone likes a pink, someone is happy with the fonts, no. So that's where, yes.
I would like to just put a point there. Because see, iterations are good, but at the early stage, as you said, but when you're actually putting it across to the customer, don't give him a lot of options, because you are an expert. If you're going there as an expert, you are an expert. You do all your research, you do all your iterations, you do 50 iterations. But when you're walking up to him, just put 2 max or 3. Don't give him 15 choices and he'll have again make him thinking what to do.
Any other questions? I think we have one there.
Yeah, I was just going to respond to that. That's all very well in a consulting, industry. It doesn't work well when products are used by end users. The end users use, and you've given those 2 iterations and those 2 iterations. So to me, iterations are not just one cycle. They need to go multiple cycles. To your question, iteration means, releasing a product, but coming back, being open that you didn't do that. That's continuous investment. And probably consultants don't get that opportunity because they move on to another project and things. I see that work.
When you have own product, I understand that because it's always going to be, you add new features, you go back to the market because it's early to market and then you build over the period of years, But when you are first design, when you have something unique and you want to put it out there, customer has given you this is my requirement and give me, when you put 15 things in front of him to make him choices for the customer, it's not at all acceptable, because then you are not taking it anywhere. But first you do your research, you go to the market, you do that iterations, that's what I'm saying. You do those 50 iterations you want to do. But when you're talking to like a stakeholder where the senior manager is coming with, I want this product to be developed, don't show him those all 50 ones.
Because certainly, you've got to be sure about which, but maybe sometimes you may have more than, I mean, I've come to a situation which I totally understand, two is a good benchmark. But maybe for A-B testing, there are people that go about multiple. So yeah, it's a good rubric, but it depends entirely on the situation.
I agree. So it's going to be a series of MVPs, but I think we have to decide, you know, where we want to limit an MVP and take things ahead, right?
But if it's a product design, you can't. There's no A/B testing, right? If you are doing something for the international customers, then A/B testing makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, it can be A/B testing. It can be, you know, multiple. Maybe you missed out. Maybe the customer missed out giving you a requirement. That is happens over and over again, where the customers don't articulate their requirements clearly. So even though you gave them things, maybe they didn't hit the ballpark. So to have a humbling effect, saying, okay, we didn't really get it right the first time. We didn't get the requirements there, but we're happy to redo. I mean, being open in that culture helps.